this year, won a state championship in football, 8-man, and also won a state championship in basketball on the girls' side. One of the huge proponents of 8-man football in state. The first 8-man game was played at his place on Thursday. Great idea, kind of get people to focus on the 8-man game. He does an amazing job, groups some great kids year in, year out. I think, again, not only being a coach in multiple sports, but being an athletic director, or an athletic administrator, because I apologize. I think he's going to bring a unique perspective on how things he has to deal with and going back and forth as from a coach to an AA. Thank you very much. So appreciate this.
Thanks, Dan. Yep. Truth be told, we built this slideshow yesterday because I don't know how to do it. So John brought John on board yesterday. I'm not. No way I'm going to be as passionate or as enthusiastic as Skip, which I think we're all well aware of. But thank you for having me, Skip. He's been trying to get me to a couple of these, and every year it's right around the end of basketball, so we've had some conflicts. But I appreciate the opportunity to ramble a little bit. Wasn't the topic I was thinking he was going to send me when I let him pick.
No, you could have done anything you want. No, don't rag me to that one.
Yeah, no, it's all you. You should be right under the AAD bus, but that's fine. So I don't know if we'll go the full hour, but if you have questions as we move forward, feel free to ask, just interrupt. I'm going to talk a little bit about who I am, just so you know me. I'm not quite as famous as Skip or Aaron or Dan. So I am at Old Orchard, really the only place I've ever been. He picked the pictures, so we had some fun with it. That was at the state game. Seth, that's happy, coach. We're about 35 seconds away from winning. But anyway, so I have been at Old Orchard. Am I too far away, John?
I don't know.
There we go. Graduated from Old Orchard Beach in 88.
I remember when you were a student at Old Orchard.
That's right, Coach Morin over back in the TA days. So I've been surrounded in that section of the state by some awesome coaches, mentors, guys that I learned from and were scared to death of, Coach Morin. Coach Troll was one a big one for me at the beach. Coach Gagne was at the beach for a while. Coach Curick was my freshman coach. Not that we had a freshman team, but a JV team before he went over to Biddeford. So Ron Cody, guys like that, Dick Agresti. I've been around all those guys most of my adult life, and I'm extremely immature, so I use that term loosely.
When you say scary, how come Joe Regina's name didn't come up?
Joe. Jesus, I sit in his office now, and he waves me out. You guys know Joe? Jesus. He played at the University of Tennessee. He was an old school guy, type of guy. First one to the bucket gets the water. You get there and you kick it over. Good guy. But so I got a lot of passion when it comes to the beach. Like I said, that's where I started. I've been a head coach for the last 21 years. I was an assistant for the previous 9. So this is 30 or 31 at the same program, which tells me OOB isn't too particular. I've done 20 years as a head basketball coach for the girls program at the beach, not consecutive, not that that matters. So I'm pretty well invested in the community. I've had 4 kids, 3 have graduated from Old Orchard, one's a sophomore, he's my quarterback right now, which is kind of cool. I'm also the athletic director. This is about my 7th year. Never ever wanted to be an athletic director. I was a pain in the ass to athletic directors when I first started. Rick Matthews, some others. Mr. Troll was my AD, and I'd call other ADs and try to change the schedule. And I was not pleasant to work with, I'm sure, looking back. But the way it happened was like how a lot of changes happened. We had a huge budget crunch in Old Orchard one year, like cutting $1.2 million in teachers, and it was chaos, and they were looking to blend jobs and make things happen. To save money, so they posted it as more of a stipend position, and they got creative. So I still teach too. I'm a full-time teacher in Old Orchard. Then I do my AD piece at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon on. But truth be told, you'll see me on my phone most mornings as I'm teaching kids. Have Skip, Roll, switched to PE now, so. So they've accommodated my schedule and they're pretty flexible, and I'm super supported by a football guy as my superintendent principal, John Suddy. I'm sure most of you know Sud. So he's passionate about athletics, so that helps. Contact info if you guys need anything from this, which strong possibility you won't, but feel free to, okay? So right now, I am my own AD. So when Skip asked how to build a relationship with an athletic director as a coach, I said, that's one slide, I'm done, thanks for having me. It's been fun, I appreciate it. Any questions? That lends itself most days to being pretty good. I know I got job security through most seasons, but it was a challenge to start because everybody looked at me as the football coach or the basketball coach, and all those programs are going to be favored. And I was like, yeah, but you're not going to notice because I'm really good at it. So I had to be super careful of how we took care of every program. Being a coach, you focus on your program, right? That's the number one program. That's the most important program. I've had to learn that's not always the case. So, yeah, nice choice. Thanks. Notes on building a program. I think this lends itself to both coaching and athletic directors. And I just got some talking points I'll fire up and ramble about as we go. And I put culture on this just to piss Skip off, because I know that's one of the buzzwords he doesn't necessarily use. So foster a culture of trust. I think that's important in, as an athletic director or a coach, right? If you're going to be a head coach, you want to be able to trust the people around you. And it's really hard for people not to get pulled in three different directions. We all know this thing called social media and things of that nature. And we're in a small community, so my coaches all have sons on the team. They all live in town. And they all shop at the same little shop called Landry's. And every aisle, you hit somebody who's got a question about what you did on Friday night or what you did on Saturday afternoon or why aren't you playing this kid. And you've got to be pretty unified publicly. And you want to be able to assume your coaches are going to do the same as an athletic director. But it has to be both ways, right? Surround yourself with good people. Sounds easy, sounds obvious, but that's a leap of faith sometimes for coaches because we're all pretty confident people, right? Almost. We all have a little ego. You gotta have an ego to coach. I firmly believe that. So you gotta set that aside when you're surrounding yourself with your staff. I know for a fact that I hire people that know more than me, certainly in certain aspects of the game. I hired John at a little league game, pretty much. Begged him to come out. His wife finally had enough of him and kicked him out of the house. You want to put yourself in a position to be successful, and you can't do it alone. So surround yourself with good people. Strive for continuity. I think we were just talking about that. Maybe even when we came in, Coach Capone and I. And I've been here for a long time, and I've seen a lot of small programs in particular that just filter through coaches every other year. And it's really hard to build continuity. So as an athletic director, I want to hire people that I have an idea are going to want to be there for a while and are workable to improve. Because if you are a revolving door in the coaching positions in your building, I think it's really hard to sustain quality programs. So I support my coaches barring any major foul-ups because I think the longer they're there, the stronger the program. Allow coaches to develop their own identity. You know, everybody coaches a little differently. So from both perspectives, a head coach or an AD, I think it's important that you let them be themselves. Everybody brings some strengths. We all know John's a soft, fuzzy people person. So we just let him do the X's and O's. But my other coach is an absolute crazy man. He's a child. Coach Weber he connects with kids on a level that's completely different than John would or than I would. He actually promotes himself on TikTok. Yeah, that's fun to monitor. I put put this one in here late, probably because my trainer was at my house having a beer with me last night while we were putting it together. But it brought up a good point. You know, they're a big part of our program. He kept a kid going through my basketball season that played the entire season with the varsity torn meniscus. Those guys are important to keep close and trust. What's that?
That's a huge part.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he's done yeoman work, and we don't have a super deep roster either, so he's a big part of teaching kids what's an injury and what's being, you know, bagged up. So build that relationship when you can. So, again, I lent the stuff we just talked about is really transcends from coach to AD, even to principal to AD, right? Building those types of relationships. So understanding your AD's job and responsibility is important. This is what I kind of didn't know. And I know, Dan, you're the only other AD in the house right now. Does anybody else do it or has done it? Just you and I, huh? All right. States in great hands. Yeah. Any questions to this point about any of the points I just discussed? Okay. So one of the things that was an eye-opener was when I got the AD's job is understanding all the things that needed to go into it. Obviously, there's multiple programs in many buildings. Ours is, you know, we're a small school, so it's not quite as full of programs. But as a coach, you know, the only program I worried about was the one I was doing. So understanding that they're overseeing multiple programs and there has to be some equity was the first big change from my perspective. And then obviously budget matters. We just went through a couple of good seasons, and with that comes additional expenses. And we were fortunate our school funded that stuff. But I know it's nice to get all those bells and whistles, and you got to go from Old Orchard to Bangor. You don't want to go on a school bus or charter a VIP bus, right? Those things aren't budgeted for. But I knew the AD, and he took good care of us, so we ended up getting the VIP budget. But those things that creep up, you know, everybody wants new equipment, everybody wants new uniforms, so prioritizing and understanding that there's a pecking order and there's a bigger picture than just what we're dealing with on our own program.
AD?
Yes, sir.
I'm real curious about the, with regards to the budget, your boosters. Are you a one booster school, or does each program have their own boosters?
You know, it's funny, that's been changing. It's, you know, that's when the tail wags the dog in our district. It's whichever parents are active tends to push it, but we've never been able to do football boosters. The only separate boosters we have in our community are band boosters, and we've had a great marching band for years, so we've kind of let them do their thing, and then we have an all-sports booster, and now we actually have PTO sports boosters, so they combined, but that's different, obviously, in every community. I'm assuming SoCo's probably got your own football boosters.
Right.
So I don't, our boosters are, you know, they do a couple of big fundraisers a year, but they're not super active year-round like some are. And I think, you know, they tap the same businesses over and over. We're such a small, I mean, 7 square miles is our town. So it's tough that way.
How do you figure out the allocation of funds?
You know, they're pretty good about it. They just take individual requests, so you got to be proactive as a coach. And again, it's whichever parents. Like right now, I have a couple of basketball moms that are active in the boosters. So I didn't do anything; they did it. It was one of those deals. So I would have asked if I had to, but it's not necessarily set in stone or policed as well as it probably could be. And they've separated themselves from the schools a little bit, so it's not necessarily, like, used to be under my auspice as AD, and they've kind kind of separated themselves from us having direct control. Anything else? All right. Planning throughout the seasons is a big part of the AD's job, right? When you're starting your season, we're usually looking ahead to the next one. We actually met Friday. Dan and I were just talking about football schedules in the back of the room. So we're already on to fall. We approved our field hockey and soccer schedules Thursday of this week. So now it'll be, you know, getting everybody to do date by date and that kind of thing. So we're usually a season ahead. And I meant to, I got a laser pointer on this too, don't I?
Yes, sir.
Is it the top button or am I going to screw this up?
Top button.
Getting back to the budget, school budgets are done in a bizarre way, and I think it's that way in every community. But we submitted our budget in January for next year because there's 15 hurdles they got to go through, public hearings and whatnot. So it's very difficult to do that if you're not communicating with your coaches. I have some coaches that are really good and dictate their needs and helps me build a budget. And I have some other coaches that always show up, you know, in June and say, hey, can we get? And I'm like, hey, check your email from December. So when you think about budget with ADs, you really got to think a year in advance to be effective. Committees, these are necessary evils, but I try to stay on committees that impact the areas that I'm involved in. So stipend committees, eligibility policy committees, things that are going to directly affect student athletes. I think it's important that ADs stay on. So it's another opportunity for coaches to have input as well. Community relations, this is probably a big one. Skip mentioned it, but we were kind of, I guess, on the forefront of the eight-man push back in 2018-19. I think it was 18-19. Mike Burnham and Mike Bisson and I had some conversations, and I was pretty excited about the opportunity. We're a small school. We've always been one of the smaller football schools in the state. I think we're fourth or fifth in terms of size. So we were always competitive, and we are a football community, but we were always just one or two away from competing for regional championships and state championships. We had a few. We've had some teams, but year in and year out, you know, we were 5-4, 4-4. Never could really get over the hump, and our rosters were low. So Mike and Mike at the MPA saw an opportunity to kind of push a coach AD in the forefront, and we kind of ran with it. So we built some community relations early because Mike and Mike didn't want to deal with it. So we were having guys, New York Times, Boston Globe, anytime there was a question about eight man, they'd funnel to us. So we got parents and kids involved in those interviews, and we had them all excited about eight man before eight man was really a thought in the state. We actually went as far, Coach Nolan in particular, connected with a bunch of coaches in the Midwest. Ohio was a big one, I think. Kansas. And he found an offense we liked and we thought we might incorporate. We actually put it in the last 11-man week we had to get the kids that were going to be returning, so most of them were excited about it. We had we felt comfortable that we could do it, and we actually ran it for a series and scored. So the kids were all in before anybody knew we were going to be going 8-man. But community relations is a big part of an AD's job. Nobody is more exposed in your school than the superintendent and the AD, right? They're always, anything that goes wrong, I had a kid's name spelled wrong on a certificate, and we got trashed. Not me, my kids, you name it, on Facebook. Because a coach, whoever, misspelled the name for a softball banquet. So you put yourself out there, but if you're proactive and you have good community relations, it goes a long way. I'm fortunate. I kind of, you know, I know most people in Old Orchard and Saco, bit of an area. So most of them like me, I think. Social media is one of those necessary evils too. I have 2 Twitter accounts, freaking Instagram that I don't know how to use, and 3 Facebook pages that I have to run as part of my athletic director job and coaching. You got to promote yourselves. You got to put positives out there, and you got to be communicative. So social media lends itself to that. Obviously, it lends itself to, you know, keyboard muscles, and everybody has the answer, but stuff that we've gotten used to a little bit. Other admin responsibilities, obviously you got to stay in touch with your building reps, your principals, assistant principals, all those things. Every teacher loves the athletic director and the coaches to be the disciplinarian, so it's good to have a good rapport with your faculty as well. Football is a great opportunity for any type of kid. So we get all types of kids, and I think some of them are the tougher version, wouldn't necessarily be stellar student athletes if they didn't have football. So we welcome and relish that opportunity to help when we can. Any questions? I kept coming back to that one because I was very, very guilty of that as a coach before I became the AD. It's important to realize, as important as football is in most schools and most communities, you're still not the only program. So my suggestion is get a schedule and go to as many events as you can, if you can, in the winter and the spring. Get connected with kids and other coaches, and it's important that programs support each other. I see a lot of schools where it feels like football is the sport in Maine, football, basketball, generally speaking. So they get a lot of publicity, they get a lot of good things for those kids, and I think it's important that you want to pit one program against another. We've done it at Old Orchard. I mean, our marching band is very competitive, and it was, you know, they use our stadium to practice. And they have a fair amount, and it's a very different culture and a very different group of people. So for a long time, there was a butting of heads, and we found a way to coexist and support each other, more so when I became the AD. But certainly I was guilty of that with the band as a head coach. Questions about just understanding the jobs and responsibilities, and I'm sure I'm leaving stuff out. Dan, any major oversights over here?
No, well done.
Yeah.
Unless you want to go on for another 3 hours.
Well, we could, but then everybody would be asleep. So, yes, sir.
As you know, all coaches and all athletic departments, do you set a time frame for, say, your wish list for the next season? I think you mentioned you can check your email on December.
Yeah.
I'm assuming you're referring to that. You know, they're asking for appointment three weeks before the season starts, rather than that then. You know, do you let them know what their allotment is so they can kind of choose wisely?
Well,
with their equipment,
I do it in two phases, or three phases, really. I talk to the coach, and then shoot them a reminder email and tell me, give me your needs, give me your wants. And I try to prioritize some balance, like, you know, go year to year. So, all right, 2 programs need uniforms. Can we do it all in 1 year? Usually I can. So we'll, I'll also, so the third phase is, come usually now, May, 1st of May, I'll get my budget update, and I'm not one to have a surplus at the end. So if I say, hey, all right, so girls soccer needed new uniforms, I got okay, I know I'm going to end up with, I'll call my reps and say, hey, can you bill me before July 1st? I don't care when I get them. So we'll order it with monies that we didn't end up using for whatever reason, you know, something that didn't need fixing, or we ended up not going in a direction we thought we were going to go. Why ever we ever have money left over, I'm going to try to spend it before July 1. So I'll hit them in November, and in season, usually the end of the season meeting, I'll hit them up too and say, hey, start thinking about what you think you might need or didn't have. We've been pretty fortunate. Nobody's gone without, and I made a real concerted effort when I started to take care of. We always have a couple of programs that it's the poor me's, you know, they always feel neglected. So I hammered them with everything they wanted when I walked through the door. You know, track got everything they wanted, field hockey got everything they wanted, and we folded. So we got a bunch of brand new equipment if anybody needs to buy some. Dan, if you're in the market, let me know.
Yeah, I'll call you.
All right, appreciate it. So yeah, I mean, there's a couple different times we try to hit them up, but it's not my money, it's the way I look at it. So if they budgeted it, I'm going to spend it on the student athletes that are in the building that year if we can. Any other questions before we, all right. So, creating positive experience for student athletes, obviously, it's, as an AD, that's what I'm looking at for my coaches. I want to make sure it's a positive experience for anybody who's participating. That could be your best player, your worst player, right? Not always easy to do for everybody, but you know, that's got to be high on the priority list as an athletic director, looking at your coaches, right? Surround yourself with amazing people. Clearly, John did this particular line last night. You want to make sure that you get coaches that are energetic, understand their sport, can connect with kids, right? Kids haven't changed, I will agree 100% with what Skip said, but expectations for coaches have changed, expectations from parents have changed, and it puts that stress on you guys. So the more amazing your coaches are, the easier your life is as an athletic director. And I'm not talking about wins and losses, right? That's a byproduct usually. Do what's right, I think goes without saying. I've always had two team rules, be on time and do what's right. I figure by the time you're in high school, if you can't be on time, you can at least communicate that. And if you don't understand what it means to do what's right, then we probably got bigger issues than what defensive scheme we're going to talk about this week. Yes, so. All right. Become part of the community. We're really fortunate right now. Where I'm at is trying to think. I think I have maybe two coaches, maybe three in the entire building, that don't live in Old Orchard or haven't graduated from Old Orchard. We're just fortunate enough to hire two more alumni, for my sub-varsity programs this spring. So we have, I think, seven or eight former Old Orchard Beach grads now coaching in Old Orchard. It's not something that we pinpoint and try to find on resumes, but I don't know that anyone in here could tell me you don't have an additional passion coaching in the community you grew up and graduated and played for. I just think it's innate, you know what I mean? Guys, to actually bring Skip back. It's huge. That's good stuff. Right? I mean, Aaron, I was just telling him how it's pretty cool when you can get alumni to come back and coach in your community. I think you could probably attest to that. You had a pretty good gig going at Cape, and your alma mater opened up. It had to be an easy decision for you.
Very much.
Yeah.
Very much.
You got any, you got half our Old Orchard staff over there, our alum too, right? Kierstead.
Other way around.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys have. So.
That's what I missed. We needed some good people. So we got a bunch of his coaches that work in our building. So, good guys, for the most part.
We say the same thing about you, John. We throw Sonny in there for the most part.
Well, that's nice. I don't believe Gamley does. Every time he sees him, he talks to him about the Noble State. All right. Be a teacher, right? Teacher of the game, teacher of life, right? Skip touched on it. I think every good football coach touches on it at some point. There's so many ways you can draw real life situations into the game of football, or really most competitive athletic events. We try to emphasize that with our coaches whenever they can. Think this one may be the most important one nowadays is how we communicate, right? It's real easy to slip up, and it's not real easy to be forgiven for. So you got to be careful, and you got to be proactive, right? So communicate with your ADs often. I tell my coaches I'd rather have you over communicate than under communicate. Holy shit, do I get a lot of emails now? So I'm on these Google Classrooms with my track coach, and I get about 40 updates a day. But I ask for it, and it works, because I know exactly what's going on. And again, I learned the hard way, because I used to do this all the time. Don't ask for forgiveness, ask for permission. I switch that around, right? A lot of people laugh and say, ask for forgiveness, don't ask for permission. Most ADs want to give you everything you need, right? And if they can, they will. So don't do something that's going to put them in a difficult spot. So communicate, ask for the world, right? But communicate so that they understand your needs. If they can't do it right then, at least they now have a building block for a budget item or a special ticket item maybe they can go to the principal for. But communicate and be proactive about it. Have a good reason and rationale for your request, because everything we do is under scrutiny, as ADs in particular, because, you know, coaches don't make the budget, so they're not responsible for the budget. But when we are spending community members' money on whatever that is, you know, we're a little bit more under the microscope than you'd think. So have a good rationale so that we can pass that rationale on. Keep up to date on potential issues. Again, if you're communicating with your AD and they're communicating with you, there's not going to be any hiccups or surprises of who's not going to be able to play Friday night because they just got in a fight in the locker room with two cross-country kids, whatever, right? It's important to stay up to date so you're not caught off guard, and no AD likes to be surprised with issues. Just had an incident in the parking lot last week, right? I had a junior baseball player back up and smash into a volunteer coach's car. And it didn't end well. But anyway, I didn't find out about it. It happened Friday. I found out Monday. Because my trainer told me, not my coach. So my coach and I had a nice chat Monday evening, and that's why you keep your trainer close. They're at everything. Kids tell them everything, too. Engage parents and community, as painful as that is sometimes. If you get them, you win them over early when things aren't going well, it's a lot easier to deal with people, right? But be honest. Don't sugarcoat stuff. You know, everybody has parent meetings, I'm sure, and we're very clear on when you can address a coach and when you can't, and how those protocols need to be set in place ahead of time so that there's no concerns. I've had pretty good run of it for 30 years, until a couple years ago we actually had to put a restraining order on a parent, which was not fun but effective, and now he's one of our biggest fans. So
imagine that.
Yeah. So, and we won, which helped, but that helps too, just for the record. It helped. Use social media to your advantage. I did find out on Facebook you can disallow people from commenting, so you can post, but they can't comment, they can dislike and share. So found out that the hard way, because I was answering a million questions on every post, or people were posting things that had nothing to do with it. It was petty stuff between different sports. So figure it out, use it to your advantage. It can be a good tool. Obviously, we all know the negatives, but it's a necessary evil nowadays. That is about all I have. If you guys have any questions, it doesn't necessarily have to be about AD stuff. If you have questions about 8 a.m. or schedules or whatever, I'm not giving you schedules, but I've seen them. We're close. Yes, sir.
Coach, you get some coaches that coach for you, but are outside the building. How do you deal with communication about grades and behavior and those kind of things when you don't have any staff that are coaching inside the building?
Yeah, I currently do have that issue in both my spring baseball and softball. They're around enough now, but that's up to me, right? That becomes an AD job too, and that's one of the reasons I encourage my coaches to go to, like, my baseball coach, go to the football game. Right, stay in legal contact with your players, because they love seeing you there, A. And B, they're going to tell you how's it going, and they'll tell you, right? So, but as an AD, kind of my job to keep them up to date. You know, if I know it's just a baseball kid, he's not going to be playing football or basketball, I'll let the baseball coach know, say, hey, you know, this kid's going through this, reach out to him, or stop by one of the games or practices or whatever. So that's on me, as an AD, I'd say.
I wore two hats as an admin and as a football coach for a long time.
Right.
You're wearing three.
Yep.
And you didn't touch on this at all, but your family fits in there somehow. Can you talk a little bit about how that fourth and real important phase fits in with the rest?
Yeah, no,
they're
absolutely.
All part of the team.
It's true. I've been very fortunate. I have three daughters that were all athletes. They played soccer and they played basketball for me. So that part was good. I don't sleep a lot, so I'm around anyway. And I don't know. They've always been part of the culture in Old Orchard. They used to go to games when I coached when they were this big, you know, and you know, now they're, it's funny, one of them's into coaching a little bit, so she's coaching some kids I coached. But my wife's she's just as touched as I am. She loves sports. She's a big fan of attending. She goes to have games where we don't even have kids in either. But I've been fortunate enough to have my kids on my teams, which makes it a little easier. And I'll be honest, I use my athletic director job to make sure that I can go to as many events as possible. So, you know, my admin's been super flexible. So I'll do two or three night practices for football a week so that I can attend the soccer games and or cross country or whatever I need to. So I was able to see my kids play, even when I wasn't coaching them, just by the nature of my job and the flexibility that they allowed. And, you know, I like to think they're getting a pretty good bang for the buck. You know, they were paying, you know, $90,000 for a full-time athletic director. I don't make 90 as an athletic director. I get about 12.5 as a stipend right now, and I just do the high school. So I've always coached, and my kids used to come along with that too, and I think it's just been part of what we do. And I live right in town, so I literally run home for an hour and I'm back in 5 minutes if something happens. So I am fortunate too. I mean, we all know John Suddy's been super flexible. He allows me to be a professional. You know, he doesn't track me or question where I am, so that part's been nice. It's not always easy, though. You know, I miss some stuff. I do. We'll see. We'll see what the future holds.
Mr. Dyer. Having been involved as a coach, like little guys all the way through, I always look at it as quality over quantity. You know, even when you're home, are you really engaged with your family? Some people aren't. I tell them guys that have gotten out of sports, I want to spend more time with my family, but they're really not engaged. I always look at it as quality, like Dean, my kids came with me, my family was involved, but they also understood that my life's work is helping kids, just like coaches is. We're helping other kids experience the things that we did, okay, to develop as men and as women. And I think if your spouse, and you, my kids, at first they were wondering what the hell's going on,
yeah.
But as they've grown older, I've had they yeah, now I know why he did it. When they see someone on the street, say, tell your father I said hi. And they explode, they don't necessarily know, you know, it's just, that's pretty special. And that's what you do. You're there for your players. And I don't look at it as a sacrifice. I look at it as a choice, personally. I mean, I would have loved to have started playing golf when I was in my when I was in my 20s. I love golf. Guess what? I couldn't do that because other things were important. Now, as my kids got older and out of the house, picking up the tab once in a while, now I'm able to play all the time. You know, although I think it's choices, not a sacrifice. Just like with your players. They're making choices. That sport is important to them. So, thanks,
Commissioner. Like an extended family.
Absolutely. I'll be here as a real student. I'm going to put Jason on the spot just look nicely. Back when there were rotary phones, which you guys don't even know what the hell those were, up on the wall, and because I never called home very often. And exactly. We had a little time. Anyway, so this one day I call home for something. I talk to my wife. My daughter answers, "Who is this?" I'm like, really? So next day I'm home, he calls. Hey, Dad, Jason's on the phone. Because that was, you know, my guys would call all the time, be around the house. And but that was all part of the big fine family. So it's all good. Guys, we're going to take a quick little break. We have all the pizza over there on the side. Okay, we're going to try to have a working lunch. Okay, we've got some of the best officials in the state here today that are going to share a few things and then basically question and answer. Things that the relationship between officials and coaches, I think, is critical. You know, I've done it in football, basketball a lot, sitting down with teams, booster clubs, whatever. Okay, really happy they're here today. Grab all you want to eat. Okay, come on back. Once we kind of get everybody settled, we'll let the officials group get started. Okay, thanks, guys.